Inside Pediatrics contains real-life surgical scenes in a hospital environment. Viewer discretion is advised. On this episode of Inside Pediatrics.
If we are going to lose her, is it going to be quick?
We need to completely reconstruct the aortic arch.
I'm beside myself.
It's a dramatic difference.
See that the pumping chamber on the left side didn't develop as well as it should have.
Not a half flow. This function could be a little bit better.
In the middle of America lies one of the busiest independent nonprofit children's hospitals in the country. Go inside the operating rooms and the transports. Go inside each family's journey, each patient's story. I'm coming home. Go inside Pediatrics at Children's Mercy, Kansas City.
You can do it.
Yeah!
Way to go.
Yay! Hi, Winston.
I'm Chad. This is my wife, Emily, and our little boy, Winston. We live in Bueller, Kansas. A small little town about an hour from Wichita.
Winston has HLHS, or hypoplastic left heart syndrome.
Hey, Winston. Hey.
Yeah.
Boop.
Yeah.
Winston is approaching his second of three major heart surgeries. Due to his heart condition, Winston will not tolerate colds or viruses as well as other kids. So Winston's parents have to restrict his contact with anyone outside the hospital.
The only people that have ever held Winston are us, our parents, his grandparents. Okay. Even my aunt and uncle haven't held him, and my sister's never held him. And you try to keep life as normal as possible, but it's not. It's still geared around 7 o'clock meds, 10 o'clock meds, 3 p.m. meds, 10 p.m. meds, 11 p.m. meds.
This is the app that some of the tech people at Children's Mercy designed. Every morning, every night, we check his oxygen saturation. At night, we get his weight, and then we also do a video recording. We normally do that in the evening as well. Uh-huh.
Yeah? Are you wanting to help?
If we didn't have all of this, we are likely, you know, still in the hospital 6 months later waiting for this second surgery.
So I think after this surgery, we can start letting people actually hold him and snuggle him, and life will be a lot more normal.
Goal today is to update you on what we saw in our fetal echo and lay out any questions that you have for us.
Today, Matt and Tara Jarvis are meeting with the fetal health team for one last discussion before their daughter Piper is born. The odds are stacking up against her.
The heart problem,
right.
The underdeveloped lungs, the facial cleft and the cystic hygroma and all these things start becoming cumulative.
Right.
And as a constellation then becomes very...
Right.
Very concerning. So we expect that she's going to be very sick.
If we are going to lose her, is it going to be quick or is
it could be quick?
Somebody's got to be there to break the news as gently as possible, understand that they go through a very big mourning process, and then help them, support them, educate them, make them as ready as they could possibly be in order to be an active participant in that.
Matt and Tara must decide how much to support Piper if she has a chance to live. Or how long they want to prolong her life if her abnormalities cannot be repaired.
I don't think that we'll be able to just draw a line in the sand.
Right.
At some point, I think that's going to be an evolution.
If we didn't do the stabilization just to assess even just the heart, at first I think we'd always struggle with what if we...
I'm fine with dealing with some achiness with removing intubation.
Yeah.
And at least knowing that everyone got to see what...
At least we know it's bad and we're just...
Yeah.
Unknowingly known it's bad.
Hi, guys.
Hey,
Dr. Selden. Hi, Millie. How are you, sweet girl?
Millie McWilliams was born with severe developmental disabilities. But since genomic testing was not available at the time, no one knew if her condition was inherited from her parents or not.
I first met Millie and her parents when she was about a year and a half old. She had abnormal blood sugars and she had lots and lots of vomiting and irritability.
How's Millie doing?
She's
good today.
Yeah?
She's having a good day.
There was a litany of tests done on her. I mean, they did every swallow test. They did x-rays.
They couldn't figure out what disease she possibly had.
And how's she doing with her arm?
You flip her hand over?
Is she sucking on it or biting it?
It's more like a bite when she's angry.
Sweet girl, don't do that.
We had to try and figure out, were her developmental problems all due to the abnormalities in blood sugar, or was there something else going on?
Dr. Soden thought genomics testing at the hospital's world-class research facility might provide some answers.
My name is Stephen Kingsmore. I'm the director of this center. It's the Center for Pediatric Genomic Medicine.
The center leads the country in pioneering new treatments for inherited pediatric diseases and finding diagnoses for children with unidentified conditions like Millie.
There are now 4,100 known genetic diseases that occur in kids. That's just staggering if you think about it. Since we started this program 3.5 years ago, we've decoded the whole genome of over 1,700 kids and parents, and we've started to put in place different programs where we can work with a physician to get a rapid diagnosis for a kid who's thought to have a genetic disease, and then to figure out, is there a treatment for that?
Genetic analysis at the Genome Center provided an answer for Millie's family, who had been living with the unknown for 7 years.
We came in to one of our office visits with Dr. Soden, and she was like, oh, I have great news. We isolated the gene.
Oh, my gosh, let's feel how big you are.
Hi, Millie.
I was kind of blaming myself for her diagnosis, and after getting the gene study, we were able to kind of move past that.
Can you look at me? Hi, Miss Millie.
Millie's case really illustrates the power of genomic medicine.
Who is that?
It is cute, like he's posing.
Is that Toby?
He just looks so snuggly.
He does.
Chad and Joanna Crossfield are back in the Fetal Health Center for a sonogram after receiving the devastating news that their unborn son, Tobin, will need immediate intensive care after birth.
When I first found out that something was wrong with him, I've never had to experience that, so I don't know how to react to it.
Oh my goodness. I can see him now.
Yeah, I see his little arm in front of his face.
It was kind of a long stretch from knowing something was wrong and then finding out how bad it really could be.
Flow through the baby's cord.
I'm feeling pretty nervous just because I'm 36 weeks now and it's sunk in, but it's not. I mean, it's real, but it's, do you know what I mean? It's just hard to deal with and come to terms with.
I'll prep one for you, okay?
Thank you.
Hi, buddy. You just missed me and wanted to come see me again.
Let
me see ya. Hi. So I've known Winston since he was around 20, 21 weeks gestation. We got a referral to Fetal Health for Chad and Emily Walgren, and made my heart turn a little bit because I've known him since we were little when our parents worked together. Oh, don't eat my hand. No, sorry.
There we go.
Beautiful shunt murmur. So Winston has hypoplastic left heart syndrome. His left side of his heart just didn't form. Let's see if I can get your blood pressure. So we do the surgeries, but we call them palliations. They're not repairs. They don't fix it. We reroute the plumbing to make it work for him. We talked Wednesday. Stats were getting a little bit lower.
He was pretty active, but he wasn't crying.
Did he look blue, like mouth, lips blue, or was it a normal check?
Lips a little bit, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Sure.
Over the last 2 weeks, I've noticed that Winston's sats are starting to trend down. The bigger he gets, that plastic tube that sends blood to his lungs is just small. He doesn't look like he's breathing hard to me at all. Does he look?
He looks a lot better today.
Even with the best care, 1/4 of the children who have HLHS don't survive all 3 surgeries. And as the day of Winston's surgery approaches, his parents are worried.
They said he's starting to outgrow his shunt, and we're a little on edge.
You're fine. You just need your surgery.
Thank you.
All right. Get dressed, buddy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chris Simons is wearing a magnet. He's part of a pioneering study at Children's Mercy to see if a surgically implanted magnet can help correct chest deformities.
Well, let's get your shirt off and let's have a look at how the chest is doing. Chris has got a condition known as pectus excavatum, where the chest wall is sunken in. It affects 1 in 1,000 kids. The sinking of the chest shifts their heart over and it compresses their lungs, so they get winded pretty easily. So we can see the magnet here. The idea of the magnet was, could we do something that we slowly change the contour of the chest, just as braces do? Right now, the more traditional methods to repair the chest and actually cut out each one of the cartilages. It's a big operation. The kids are in the hospital for about 5 days recovering afterwards. Chris hasn't had to be in the hospital at all.
Well, I can just see from the amount of the magnet's protruding now compared to where we were when we started.
Yeah. And you can see the magnet implanted on his chest here. And this sits on the front of the chest bone, and then behind it is a plate sort of sandwiching the chest bone. And then Drew has to create the brace that goes on the outside with the other magnet in it to pull the internal magnet out. So what kind of discomfort are you having now?
Just like pain in the bone, stretching and pulling.
Each time the kids come back, we have to make minor adjustments on the brace, because if that brace doesn't fit right, if it doesn't align the magnets right, the chest isn't going to pull out.
The alignment's pretty good, don't you think?
Yeah,
the alignment. All right, so let's get your 3-month pictures here, okay? I'll have to email you some of the before and after pictures, because it's a dramatic difference.
He and his friends have fun throwing magnets at his chest and letting it stick and see who can get the most magnets to stick to his chest.
Thank you, okay.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you.
All right, buddy.
Check it out.
Be good.
So, morning of the surgery. I think Winston's ready, but I don't think we are.
You ready?
Winston and his family have waited 7 months from this first surgery to the second surgery. The day has finally arrived.
All right. I'm just going to start with an anatomy of the heart. The right side of the heart developed just fine. But you see that the pumping chamber on the left side didn't develop as well as it should have. So now what we need to do is take advantage of the good pumping chamber that he has on the right side and use that to do the more important job, which is pumping that blood out to the body. We'll go ahead and do our connections, come off the heart-lung machine, leave a couple drains in place, and close everything up. We'll keep you updated, and I'll talk to you in a couple of minutes. Okay? Yeah. All right. One of the happiest babies.
All right.
Winston Walgren and Dr. O'Brien is going to do a bidirectional gland and take down of right modified Blalock tessic shunt via redo median sternotomy.
All right, maybe. So the surgery today is called a bidirectional gland. So what we're doing now is we're taking the blood that comes back from the body to the heart, and instead of having it go back to the heart, putting it right into the lung vessels directly.
He was born with just the right side heart, not the left side. Because he doesn't have the left side, we're asking the right side of the heart to pump blood to the body. And it's not designed to do that. It's designed to do an easier job, just to pump blood to the lungs. So up until this point, it's been pumping blood both to the body and to the lungs. So it's been doing double duty. After this surgery, we'll be doing half the work that it was doing, so the heart function will be much happier. We got most of the heart dissected out. So we're within this pericardium, within the sac that the heart sits. And so You can see this is all the right side of the heart. And this is a big vein that comes from the upper half of the body called the superior vena cava. And this is the vein that brings all the blood back from the upper half of the body that now, instead of going into the heart, we're going to connect that right into the lung vessels. So far, we're coming along very nicely. So now we're going to go on the heart-lung machine.
We take all the blood back from the heart, and then we oxygenate it and take off the CO2, and then we put it back into the aorta.
Reading 61 on the pump, 53 for patient.
So went on bypass at about 10 o'clock, so probably about 30 more minutes of work inside of the heart, and then we'll wean him off the heart-lung machine, let his heart start functioning on its own.
Feel better that they're inside the heart and halfway done. Thankful things are going well so far.
Okay.
What's up? Around the year 2000, Bill Clinton and Tony Blair got on the TV and told us the human genome is sequenced. For a long period after that, there wasn't an understanding of what the information would look like or how a physician would manage it.
And that's a huge step for us, you know, to go from a program that works for a couple of kids in a couple of settings to this bigger vision now that we want to be the leading genomic medicine hospital in the country.
As we go along, we're gaining experience and we're gaining practical information. And so gradually, we've seen more and more physicians realize, you know, this is going to fundamentally affect how we practice medicine.
That means a lot of master classes.
In a master class, physicians submit their own DNA for analysis. By reviewing their unique genetic code, doctors learn how genomics can help identify inherited conditions and forecast the probability of future problems.
We have 16 physicians who are going to roll up their sleeves and really get very intense educational experience in genomics. Okay, so
it's WNT10A. It has a frequency of about 1.8%. It causes toothagenesis. And in fact, we have at least three people that I know of in my family who have multiple teeth missing. So at least three people. I think I know all of them, man.
Dr. Le Pichon is a neurologist, and he found a condition that explains why his sister and his son have differences in their teeth.
So there you go. I just found out what's wrong with our family.
How interesting it is to be an endocrinologist and to see that I'm a carrier for a bona fide disease-causing allele.
You are.
Or a disease that I treat.
By compiling genomic data from doctors and patients, Children's Mercy is creating a genomic data warehouse, which can help physicians around the world translate this complex information into practical applications for medicine.
I definitely saw light bulbs going on around the room. That's what we were hoping, and that's what we saw today.
Now, we're just finishing the connection between the superior vena cava, the big vein that comes from the upper half of the body, and the pulmonary arteries. So now, once we're done with this, all the blood flow from the upper half of the body will go right into the lungs. We're almost finished, and when we're finished with this, we'll be able to come off the heart-lung machine and let his own heart do the work that the machine is doing for him now.
We're just making sure everything is safe and that it's where we want it to be before we just take him off the machine.
All right, why don't you come down to 3/4 flow, please?
Down 3/4.
Not a half flow.
Down half.
All right, I just need some function to come back. This function could be a little bit better. I think I just need some time. Can I go back up to full flow and empty out, please? I'm just gonna let him rest for a little bit here. Upper half of the heart's beating, but the lower half's not beating in coordination, so we're just gonna take over the pacing for him temporarily. So those are temporary pacing wires. So those are allowing us to pace his heart at the moment. He's had a history of unusual rhythms, and you know the heart always has to recover a little bit after having surgery on it, and so we're not pacing for him. My expectation is that he'll come back into his regular rhythm.
So we went back on bypass for another 10 minutes or so, and by that point, everything was fine.
Flame pressures are good. RV function's looking much better. And now we're just going to take the cannulas out and then close.
He was already showing signs of having his own native rhythm coming back just within the first few hours afterwards.
All right, big boy.
He tolerated the surgery very well.
Winston's the toughest little dude I know.
A lot tougher than us.
Oh, do you have my makeup?
That's
like
right there.
The only important thing.
It's right there.
Of the hospital, every girl knows that.
Movies, that's important.
Movies, yeah, pack the movies.
Today, Tara and Matt Jarvis prepare to go to the hospital for Piper's birth. The harsh reality of what is to come can't be avoided any longer.
We've had a lot of family come in and we all had a lot of fun. Everyone's been really good until about today. Today it's been like, crap. Now all the stuff we've been talking about has to happen. That sucks. And if I get upset, you know, Grandma and Mom get upset because they can do absolutely nothing. They're just here to help. I'm ready to look forward, which is the only thing that makes me feel better.
Chad Riggenborn and Joanna Crossfield are already in the labor and delivery room, knowing Tobin will be born soon. Like the Jarvises, they're scared.
I don't know to be excited or nervous. I'm a lot of everything. I'm beside myself.
I'm excited that he's gonna get here, but I'm scared for what he's gonna have to face. I don't think I've ever been this scared of anything in my life.
On the next episode of Inside Pediatrics.
Push, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
It was literally sticking out from the tip of her nose.